Last December, I worked with my friend and fantastic mathematician, Hannah Fry, to write and deliver the Royal Institution Christmas lectures. To be fair, Hannah did the bulk of the work, but still I'm taking 50% of the credit. Now, we did some great joint bits that we were very proud of, but one of them has become particularly poignant since then. We looked at the mathematical implications of the accuracy of testing, and given there's a lot of discussion about that now, I thought it might be good to clip out just that part of one of the lectures and make it available here on my YouTube channel. Enjoy.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Hannah Fry. Welcome to the Royal Institution Christmas Lectures. When you are dealing with the messy world of uncertainty, you need to understand that being wrong is sometimes part of prediction, because sometimes errors can have unexpected consequences. Now, let me show you what I'm talking about here, because we have just had a delivery of 100 Christmas presents, and the rumours are that hiding amongst these 100 presents, there are 5 brand new smartphones. And one of you gets to come down and open one of these presents at random. Who wants to come down and... What a surprise. Perfect. All right, so let's see who we can find. If you want to come down there, yeah, perfect. Round of applause. What's your name?
Yiling.
Yiling, perfect. Okay, Yiling. All right, so if you want to stand over, just over there. Now, you're going to get to pick one of these presents completely at random. 5 of them are phones. The other 95, they're kind of rubbish presents, like socks and satsumas. No one wants any of them. And because you only get to pick one present, we want to give you the best possible chance at getting a phone. But luckily, Matt Parker has invented a very special present scanning machine to help you. So, come here, Matt. Look at this.
Right.
Yeah. Amazing.
This is my Xmas ray detector 0.80. And what we can do is we can put these presents through the scanner. Actually, do you want to come with me around over here? If you want to stand behind like the conveyor belt over here where they come out, if I turn this machine on and I start putting the presents in the top here, it will try and detect if there's a phone in them. If there's no phone, it just spits them out the same way they went in. If it thinks there's a phone, it rewraps it. Look at that. Ah, oh, that's a winner. So if it says phone, you put it on the table. If it doesn't say phone, we don't care, right? Just down there somewhere. Is that okay? Are you ready? I'm gonna start piling them in here.
You sort
them out. Here they come.
You seem pretty happy with this machine.
I'm very proud.
Yeah. It is, how accurate is it?
This machine is 80% accurate.
Okay, 80% accurate. That's pretty good, Matt. Good. 80% accurate. Okay, so then one of these then that's rewrapped as a phone, what do you reckon are the chances that this is a phone? Shout out what you think it is. Okay, all right, let's think this through then. So your machine, how accurate is your machine?
80% accurate.
Okay, so your machine is 80% accurate. There are 5 phones in total. 80% accurate means that it's only going to find 4 of them, right? Which does, yeah. Matt, that does mean one phone's going to end up on the floor.
Yes, the downside to 80% accurate is it's 20% inaccurate. But on the upside, 80% accurate.
Okay, so, I mean, you make a good point.
Thank you.
So, okay, one phone on the floor, it's not the end of the world, still gives you a really good chance at finding a phone. There's something going on there, though. Hang on. Stop the machine.
Whoa.
Okay, hang on. Matt?
Yeah?
There are way more than 4 phones on that table.
Yeah, it's 80% accurate at both detecting a phone and detecting not a phone.
Are you saying this machine is taking socks and satsumas and wrapping them as phones when they're not?
Yeah, 20% of them. I don't know if I brought this up earlier, Hannah, but it's 80% accurate.
Yeah, but Matt, there's 95 socks and satsumas here.
Yeah.
20%, that's 19 rubbish presents in that pile of phones.
Yeah, but 80% of them are down here. So the problem is, this is 80% accurate. It doesn't mean these are going to be 80% phones.
Yeah.
It just means, and I'd like to recap, that my machine is 80% accurate.
Okay. But right, by the time you're finished, you're going to have, what, 23 presents over here. Only 4 of them are going to be phones.
Yep.
That gives you a 4 in 23 chance of finding a phone.
17%.
So it wasn't, okay, well, do you want to pick one at random? I mean, you can open it, have whatever's inside. It's overwhelmingly likely to be. It's that's Zuma. Well, you can keep it though. Merry Christmas. Thanks for your machine, Matt.
My pleasure.
Amazing.
80% accurate.
That kind of error, mislabeling Satsuma's phones, it's something that's called a false positive. And it goes to show how maths can sometimes really prove your intuition is wrong. Now, false positives, they're everywhere. You see this every time you go through an airport. Think about all of the people that are pulled over from the scanner for having lip balm and hair straighteners in their luggage. And the number of people who are false positives massively overwhelms the number of real weapons that the security team are looking for. But there is a really dark side to this kind of error too, because imagine if instead of scanning for presents, we were screening for cancer. Now, even if a cancer screening test, like a blood test or a mammogram, the ones that work with 89% accuracy, because they are not perfect, there will always be false positives. There will always be people who believe that they have cancer when in reality they actually have nothing to worry about. This is kind of present scanning, but from the perspective of the gift box. And you can imagine just how much pain and anxiety it might cause to be mislabeled. Now, this doesn't mean that you shouldn't be screened, but it's really important to understand what these results mean.
If you would like to now watch all three lectures, and they are 1 hour each, you can head over to the Royal Institution's YouTube channel. Originally, the lectures were broadcast on the BBC, and I apologize everyone else who's not in the UK who couldn't watch them, but now they've been put up on the RI channel. So wherever you are in the world, they're not geo-locked, you can watch them. Do enjoy them, and you should subscribe to the RI channel. I do videos for them occasionally as well. They've got some amazing content. Do go check them out.